Hello and welcome to the session. This is Professor Farhat. In this session, we're going to be looking at the at-risk limit rules that deals with investor losses. This topic is covered in an income tax course, the CPA exam regulation section, as well as the enrolled agent exam. As always, I would like to remind my viewers, that's you, to connect with me on a personal as well as a professional level. Please, if you have a LinkedIn account, connect with me on LinkedIn. If you don't have a LinkedIn account, you should create a LinkedIn account. It's good for your professional image. If you're a Facebook user, please like my Facebook page and connect with me on a personal level. You should always subscribe to my YouTube. This is where I house all my lectures. Please like my YouTube, share them, and put them in playlists so other people can benefit. And if you have a Twitter account, please follow me on Twitter. And on my website, you can find all my courses organized by chapter, so it's easy retrieval. Now, this recording is brought to you by Yeager CPA Review. If you like this recording, you can view hundreds of hours of video lectures on Yeager CPA Review, plus thousands of multiple choice questions with detailed solution. So if you're studying for your CPA or if you're an accounting student, you can supplement your resources. Simulation textbook, including a physical textbook, audio lectures for retention, electronic flashcards, plus many others. Now, this is really a good value offer at Yeager CPA Review if you are an accounting or a CPA student. You could also get 10% off if you use my promo code PMF. You will benefit yourself and benefit this channel. So what is the idea of the chapter today? What's the idea of this session, to be more specific? Well, we have to go back to the 80s, early 80s to be more specific. What was happening in the 80s? Well, in the 80s, the first thing you want to remember, or you're not going to remember, but the first thing you want to know is we had a high marginal tax rate. So the highest marginal tax rate was 50%. So at some point, a taxpayer would be, if they're making a lot of money, once they exceed a certain amount, they are paying 50%. They're sharing their profit 50-50 with the federal government. So the tax rate was high. So people were looking to find ways to shelter their income. We had a depreciation system called MACRS. Now, what you learned about MACRS. MACRS is coming from ACRES. ACRES stands for Accelerated Cost Recovery System. Then you're going to see why MACRS comes into place. Because what we did is we slowed down depreciation. Depreciation was accelerated. So the first few years, you'll pretty much take all your depreciation. In the early 80s, interest rate was high. Interest rate was high. It means borrowing money would generate a large interest expense. So given all this scenario in the early 80s, you had people with money, doctors, lawyers, people with money that they wanted to, people that are making a lot of money, and they wanted to shelter their income. So somehow they wanted to find a way to pay less taxes. Okay, so the tax environment really kind of led them to real estate. So what you do is this. So this is basically a scenario that my uncle still believed it still exists. That's why I put my uncle here, because my uncle lived during the 80s and he still believed that people are still doing this, which is people are not doing this anymore. But let me tell you how it works. So you have, let's assume, two doctors and a lawyer here, and they're making good money. So therefore, they're in the high tax bracket. They're paying 50%. They wanted to kind of shelter their income. So what they would do is this. Each one of them, they will contribute. Just let's say, for example, let's make it... $30,000. So each one of them will contribute this much, and they will create a limited liability company. They put $90,000, then they will borrow $910,000, just to kind of make it easy. So all in all, they have a company that's worth $1 million. Okay, and what they would do, they will invest in strip mall, just kind of rental property. Okay, just to kind of give you a picture. And what happened is this. Now, obviously, what's going to happen is this. They're going to rent the place, so they're going to have revenues. But since we have acres, they're going to have a large acres deduction. Since they borrow this money, they're going to have a large interest expense, and they're going to have other operating expenses. So all in all, they're going to experience losses. They're going to be experiencing losses. And as a result, they will take those losses. So they have losses on one end, okay? And they have income, business income, because we're going to assume they're self-employed. Okay, they're gonna have business income or W-2 if they're working in hospitals. So they're gonna have income. So what they would do, and they will have, let's assume they will have, let's assume this doctor will have $250,000 of income from their work, okay? And from the losses, let's assume the losses for the year were 300,000. Okay, so what happened if the losses are 300,000 from this strip mall, each one of them will absorb 100,000. So this doctor here, she made $250,000 from her business, then she's gonna get $100,000 of losses. Those losses will offset her income, and her income becomes 150,000. Now she's gonna pay only taxes on 150,000, so she's most probably not in the 50% tax bracket, okay? And same thing with the other doctor and the lawyer. They will reduce their income from their wages by incurring losses from those strip malls. Once again, my uncle believes that type of deal still exists. So you can see where the problem is. So it's the tax shelter. So the Congress said, well, hold on a second, we need to do something about this, okay? And this is where the whole idea of at-risk limits and passive losses activities, it's gonna come into place. I just wanted to set the environment for this chapter so you know why does this chapter exist. So this is the reason for it. Now bear in mind, and here's what would happen after two, three years, these guys, this company here, you know, formed of these three investors, will sell the strip mall and they will have a capital gain. And capital gain is taxed lower than ordinary income. So they will lower their ordinary income, then they will turn around, take this business and sell it, and it's considered capital gain. Or sometimes what they do, they sell it and they buy another business, they don't pay taxes, they exchange it, and they keep doing this. So Congress said, hold on a second, we need to stop this. Because people were losing faith, such as my uncle, that rich people, in quote, people with money are avoiding paying taxes. So this is the whole idea behind the at-risk rule, but we're gonna be a little bit more specific, but hopefully I put you in this picture. So this is the tax shelter problem. And rental real estate was a big industry that sheltered money. Okay, so let's take a look at a little bit more specific example about the cattle breeding industry that also people were involved in this cattle breeding business. So let's take a look at this example with numbers. Bob, who earned $400,000 as a business executive and dividend income of $15,000, he invested $20,000 for a 10% interest in a cattle breeding tax shelter. So what they did, it was all sorts of businesses. Cattle breeding was one of them. Through the use of $800,000 of non-recourse financing and available cash of $800,000, the partnership acquired a herd of exotic breed of cattle costing $1 million. So what they did is they borrowed $800,000 non-recourse. It means no one is responsible for this individually, and they have cash available of all the investors together, $200,000. So they have $1 million. So depreciation, interest, and other deduction related to the activity amounted to losses of 400,000. So the cattle breeding business, in quote, okay, created losses of 400,000, of which Bob owns 10% of the business. They're gonna get 40,000 of losses. Bob was allowed to deduct the 40,000 losses even though he had invested and stood to lose only $20,000. So Bob's investment, only $20,000, the loan is non-recourse. They can't go after them individually, okay? So the net effect of the deduction from the partnership was that the portion of Bob's salary and dividend was sheltered, okay? Offset or neutralized by the deduction. So although he had W-2 from his executive job, he had interest dividend income, that income was reduced. So basically, if we take 415,000, we're gonna reduce the income by $40,000. And basically now Bob pays taxes on 375,000. Okay, assuming Bob was in the 40% tax bracket, Bob already saved $16,000 on his income, on his taxes, by investing only $20,000 in this cattle breeding business. And most probably he knew nothing about it. Just he invested this money just to get the losses. So from the losses, he can reduce his taxable income. Then at what they would do at the end, they will sell this business. And if they pay taxes, it will be a capital gain tax. So it's very interesting scheme that was going on. So Congress was aware of this and said, no, we're gonna stop. And the first response to this is the at-risk limit. So what is the at-risk limit? Simply put, I'm gonna simplify it, then I'm gonna go into details. Basically, you can deduct up to what you actually invested. the amount of money that you invested or the amount of money that you are at risk for. So in case something happened, you would lose it. So how do we define at risk? Okay, so the amount, the taxpayer economic investment in an activity, which is the amount of cash, it's what you invested in cash, what you contributed, and the adjusted basis of property. Well, if you contributed property, it's your adjusted basis, plus any amount borrowed for use in the activity for which the taxpayer is personally liable. It's non-recourse, it's a recourse. Recourse means what? Recourse, that means you went to the bank, you borrowed money. If the loan is recourse, you don't pay that money, they will come after you personally. If the loan was non-recourse, which is what we saw with Bob's situation, guess what? You don't pay it. If something happened and the business can't pay it, no one is responsible for it. The bank took that risk. So it's a recourse that it's part of your at risk because you are at risk of losing, or you pledged at a security property not used in the activity. Or if you went to the bank and you pledged a property against the loan, technically it's kind of a recourse loan because you're responsible for it. So the amount that you invested, the basis of the property that you contributed, plus the loan that's recourse debt, or you pledged the property against it. Okay? At-risk amount does not include non-recourse debt unless the activity, so there's an exception for this, unless the activity is for real estate activity, qualified recourse financing, including in determining the at-risk limitation. Or if you're in real estate and it's a qualified real estate financing, it means they can come after you, take your property, although it's non-recourse, but it's a real estate deal. So there's an exception. That's the first response to the at-risk limit. You can only deduct what you are at risk for. The second category, the second layer, or the second line of defense from Congress or from the IRS was, now what's going to happen is you're going to have to break down your income into three separate categories. We're going to have the first category is active income, which consists of your salaries, wages, profit from business, like if you have a business, Schedule C, or sale of asset from your business. So this is the sale of asset from your business. This is what's considered active income. So this is important. Then you're going to have a portfolio income. Portfolio income would include interest, dividend, annuities, sale of assets that produce investment. And the third type of income is passive income. What is passive income? Passive income is when the taxpayer does not materially participate. Now, what does it mean, materially participate? Simply put, they don't participate in the business. So they are basically kind of silent or not active. They don't make any decision. But don't worry, we're going to define this not materially participate much, much more in details, because it matters if you materially participate or not materially participate. So to simplify it, passive is, think about the doctors and the lawyers that we started with the example. So this is the doctor and the lawyers, where they're not in the business of running a strip mall. They just invested their money and they let it go. Okay, so this is what passive income is. Now, what happened is this. So the response was, if you have a passive income, okay, the first thing that they say, it's disallowed, if you have passive losses, it's disallowed to be deducted against active or portfolio income. So simply put, you cannot take losses from 3 to offset 2 and 1. What does that mean? It means if you have passive losses from 3, you will see if you have any passive income from somewhere else. Maybe you do have another passive income business, strip mall, where it's making profit, then you can offset your profit against this. So this is the second layer of defense. And I'm really simplifying. We're going to have to look at this much, much more in details. Now, the risk, the computation of what amount of risk is involved, it's going to start simple, basically the cash that you put in, the adjusted basis, but it's going to change over time. And at something's going to increase your at-risk amount, and some stuff, it's going to decrease your at-risk amount. So you need to know what increases your at-risk amount and what decreases at-risk amount. Why? Because it's going to determine how much you can deduct. Well, cash and the adjusted basis of the property contributed, that's going to increase, obviously. Amount borrowed for the use and the activity for which the taxpayer is personally liable and has pledged the security, that's also allowed. Taxpayer share of amount borrowed for use in the activity that are qualified non-recourse financing, this is in real estate, and taxpayer share of activities income. So as we make more income, as the business make more income, if they generate income, your at-risk amount goes up. Okay, we already talked about those, but this is the third one, because when the company operate, when that limited partnership or LLC operates, if they generate income, The income that you generate, it's going to increase your at-risk amount. What's going to decrease your at-risk amount? If you make any withdrawal from the activity. If you put money, it's going to increase. If you take money out of the business, it's going to reduce your at-risk amount. Taxpayer share of activity losses. It's the opposite of income. If the business generated losses, it's going to reduce your at-risk amount. And taxpayer share of any reduction of debt for which recourse against the taxpayer exists, or a reduction of qualified non-recourse debt. Simply put, it's the opposite of this. If the debt that you are responsible for is going down, your at-risk amount is going down as well. So basically, in a sense, they're the opposite of each other. If you contribute money, it increases your at-risk amount. If you withdraw money, it reduces it. So hopefully it makes sense to you, okay? Let's take a look at an example just to make sure we understand the at-risk amount concept. In the current year, Ed invests $30,000 in oil partnership. What's going to happen with that $30,000? It's going to increase his at-risk amount. His taxable income in the current year was $2,000. Well, the business made income. That's going to increase your taxable, your at-risk amount. And he withdrew $10,000. Well, guess what? That's going to reduce your at-risk amount. So all in all, the at-risk amount for Ed is $22,000. So if you compute the at-risk amount, it's $22,000. Now, this is basically an introduction to this chapter, basically to just give you an idea that passive losses cannot be easily deducted against active income and portfolio income. First, we have to use the at-risk rule. Then we're going to have to use the passive activity loss limits, which is, and they're going to have to work together. So make sure you understand this chapter step by step before we move on. In the next session, we're going to talk about passive activity loss limit. If you happen to visit my website, if you're studying for your CPA, first of all, make sure you study hard. If you're studying for your courses, study hard. If you happen to visit my website for additional lectures, please consider donating. Good luck.